Hello guys, welcome to my channel. In this video, I'll be explaining the architecture of JVM, that is the Java Virtual Machine architecture. As you know, Java application contains many Java classifiers, right? So the main function of the JVM is to load and execute the Java application. Let's say for example, your application has one class, one Java class, that is myClass.java. And if you want to compile that myClass.java, we will use javac myClass.java file command. When we use that command to compile the myClass.java file, then it generates a .class file and that has the bytecode for your Java source code. So the compilation is the process of converting Java source code into the bytecode. Once the bytecode is generated and is present in a .class file, we generally tries to execute that .class file. So when we try to execute it, we invoke a command java myclass. Whenever we give java myclass command to execute the program, which means that then the JVM comes into picture. A JVM instance will be created whenever we invoke Java on a particular class. JVM instance will be created to load and execute the given class. So the JVM has couple of subsystems, like class loader subsystem, like this, and the runtime data areas, and the execution engine. If you see, the runtime data areas are having method area, heap area, Java stacks, program counter register, native method stacks. Execution engine is having interpreter, JIT compiler, and their execution engine is communicating with the native method interface and the libraries and the operating system. We'll talk about all these concepts in detail in the subsequent slides. Let me start with the class loader subsystem. So whenever we invoke Java command on a particular class file, then the class loader subsystem first comes into picture as part of the JVM instance. So the class loader subsystem again having the three phases: load, link, and initialize. Let me start with the load phase. What will happen in the load phase? Load phase, it actually does the loading of the bytecode, that is your .class file, into the memory. It can load the bytecode from various sources like network sockets. Like in our example, when you call Java myClass, the class loader loads the bytecode from the file system. Along with the file system, it can also load the data from the network sockets. In the load phase, whenever a class wants to be loaded by the class loader subsystem, then there are three types of class loaders available in class loader subsystem: bootstrap class loader, extension class loader, and the application class loader. Bootstrap class loader is actually responsible for loading the internal classes. Those are distributed with your JDK implementation. Whenever you install JDK, some jar files will come along with the distribution, along with the installation. Those jar files, though the classes present in those jar files, will be loaded by this bootstrap class loader. Coming back to extension class loader, there is a JRE libEXT folder in your JRE directory. So the classes, whatever classes you place in that particular directory, they will be loaded by the extension class loader. Next one is application class loader. So whenever we are running a Java command along with a class name, We generally mention hyphen cp parameter sometimes. So hyphen cp, we provide the class names. So those class names which are provided along with hyphen cp will be loaded by the application class loader. Also, we generally set the class path whenever we install the Java, right? We generally set the class path in our environment variable, system environment variable. So whatever the class is defined in that class path directory, they also will be loaded with the help of application class loader. So that is about the load phase. So load phase is actually helpful to load the file, to load the bytecode into the memory. And the loaders are Bootstrap class loader, extension class loader, and the application class loader. Once the class is loaded into the memory, then the link phase will start. If you see, the link phase is again has the three steps: verify, prepare, and resolve steps. Even though they are depicted here, sequential execution, they may run in parallel, or their execution may overlap with each other sometimes based on the JRE implementation or the JVM implementation. In the verify step, JVM actually checks whether the bytecode is proper or not, whether it is a valid Java bytecode or not, whether this bytecode can be interpreted by the Java interpreter or not. Those kind of checks, bytecode verifier checks basically, those kind of checks will be done in the verify phase. Once those checks are passed, are successfully completed, that it is a valid bytecode, it can be understood by the JVM, Java interpreter, then prepare phase will start. In this step, memory is actually allocated for the class level static variables in the prepare step. When I say class level static variables, let's say for example in our class file, in our Java my class, in our my class file, right, I have created one static variable at class level, not within any method, at class level, private static boolean is eligible is equal to true. So that memory allocation for that variable, static variable, which is eligible, is allocated at this point of time. When the memory is getting allocated for the static variable in the prepare step of the link phase, right, it will be assigned with the default values. Even though you assign some actual value to the class level static variable in the prepare phase, when the memory is getting allocated for that specific variable, it will be assigned with the default value. Like for boolean, the default is false, right? The false value will be stored in the boolean variable in this phase. Once the memory allocation for static variables, class level static variables, is done, the resolve phase comes into picture. So in the resolve phase, right, all symbolic references, like if your class is having any references to the constant pool, symbolic references to the string constant pool, or if your class is having any references to another classes, right, they will be resolved here in this step. I mean, they will be referred and resolved in this step. So that is about the link phase of the class loader subsystem. Let me go to the initialize phase. In the initialize phase, it is actually responsible for executing your static initializers. Like as mentioned in the prepare step, we have taken one example, right? What is that? We have created one static variable, class level static variable, private static, is eligible, private static boolean is eligible is equal to false, true. Okay, so in the prepare step it was assigned with the default value in the memory when it was when the memory is allocated for the first time in the prepare step. But in the initialize phase, whatever the value we have assigned in the code, the actual value that will be assigned to that variable in the initialize phase for the static variable. Also, not only the static variables, if you are if your class is having any static initializer, static block like static open brackets and close brackets, and you are writing something in that static block, that will be called a static block. The code that is written in the static block also will be initialized in this initialize block, initialize phase. That is about the class loader subsystem. Before we move on to the next phase of the JVM, next component of the JVM or the next subsystem of the JVM, let me tell you about the two exceptions which we generally see. In general, we see the class not found exception or the class definition not found exception. Class not found exception, right? Generally, it will be coming in the load phase of the class loader subsystem, because the load phase is the one which actually loads the class into memory, right? So class not found, when the class loaders are unable to load a class, class not found will come, exception will come. There is another exception, class def not found exception. So class definition not found exception will come in the resolve phase, because if you are referring class B in class A, then if it is actually the class B reference is actually being resolved in the resolve phase, right? That's why if the class B is not available to load, then the class definition not found exception will come in the resolve phase. That's all about the class loader subsystem. Let me go to the runtime data areas. So as we talked about it in the first slide, runtime data areas is have are there are five different types of runtime data areas: method area, heap area, PC registers, Java stacks, native method stacks. Okay, let me start with the method area and heap. So the method area is having only the class level data. Okay, like class level static variables, class level constant pool, the bytecode, class metadata that will be useful for the reflection API. Okay, all the data will be there in the method area. The method area is the space that is allocated to your JVM. The size of the method area will be the size of your minimum space allocated to your JVM. By default, 64 MB. Space is allocated to method area. Okay, so in method area we basically the class level data like static variables, constant pools, bytecode, all the class level data, metadata, class metadata that is required for reflection API will be stored here. Suppose if you are loading so many classes, right? All those classes, static variables, constant pools, bytecode, and the metadata information will be loaded into this method area. Suppose if you are loading some 1 million, 2 million classes, and those classes information will not be stored in the method area. Method area is by default is having the 64 MB memory size, right? So if they are not able to store in that 64 MB, then we will get java.lang. out of memory error for permgen space, permanent generation space. So in order to increase it, in order to increase the method area size, we have to set this parameter -xx:max perm size. This is all applicable I mean, the permgen space of 64 MB and increasing it with this parameter is applicable till Java 7. Since Java 8 onwards, the method area is removed and is moved to some memory location called metaspace in the native operating system memory. So from Java 8 onwards, there is no limit for the method area. It can use whatever memory is available in the native operating system. But we can tune in the metaspace available memory or the allocated memory for the metaspace as well. That is about the method area. Coming to the heap area, heap is actually having the instance level data, object level data. Method area is having the class level data. Then heap is having all the object level data. All instance variables of a class are created in heap. Arrays are also created in heap. We can fine tune this heap area size, that is minimum heap size and the maximum heap size with the minus XMS and minus XMX parameters. So we generally generally tackle the heap memory fine tuning operations as a Java developer or the Java programmer. We generally run into the java.lang.out of memory errors with out of heap memory errors. So in order to tackle them, either we have to fine tune our program by reducing the number of classes creation or by increasing the heap memory size or limiting the heap memory size, limiting the data that we put in the heap memory. All these operations we can take in order to fine tune the heap memory. That's all about the method area and heap data areas. Coming to the PC registers. PC registers means the program counter registers. PC registers contains each, there will be some set of registers. Okay, it contains the address of the next executable instruction per thread. Okay, let's say for example, there are currently three threads are running in your Java program. Okay. T1, T2, and T3. Okay. Address of the next executable instruction will be their pointer, basically. Pointer to the next executable instruction will be there here in the of thread T1 will be in the T1, of thread T2 in T2, of thread T3 in the PC register T3. So this is all for per thread. Okay. Coming to the Java stacks, this is where whenever we write a Java class, right, we write some methods or some properties on it, right? So every class will be having some methods in it. So Java methods will be loaded and executed in the Java stacks. Okay. Let's say for example, there are three threads running. And threads T1, T2, and T3. Thread T1 is having three methods. Okay. T2 is having two methods. T3 is having one method. Okay. So T3 is having three methods, and its first method, method one, is called, and it will be stored in the stack frame. In this stack frame. Suppose if method one is calling stack frame. If method one is calling method two, then the method two will be loaded in the next stack frame on the Java stack of for that thread. Okay, if method two is calling method three, then the new stack frame will be created and method three will be pushed into that stack frame. Once the method three execution is completed, that will be removed from the stack. Once the method 2 execution is completed, that will be removed from the stack. Once the method 1 execution is completed, that will be removed from the stack. In this way, the method that is currently loading, that will be there at the top of the stack frame. in the Java stack memory area. Okay, that is about the Java stack. There is another stack which we have native method stacks. Let's say for example, one of the Java method wants to interact with the native methods like executing a DLL and all, right? So whenever we call a native method to execute a DLL, that native method will be executed in the native method on a separate stack, that is the native method stack. Once that is completed, the control will be given to the Java method stack and its execution will be completed. So for example, we have one recursion concept, right? In any programming language, recursion means a function calls itself. So whenever any function is calling itself, that is called as recursion. Let's say for example, there is method one, okay? The method one is calling itself so many times. So those as many times it was called, those many frames will be, stack frames will be created. But we forgot to write the exit condition for that recursive call. So many, many stack frames will keep on piling up. So in that situation, we generally comes into a picture, error like Java stack overflow error, java.lang.stackoverflowError. In such cases, either we have to find out the reasons why the stack frames are not getting popped up, why the stack frames are getting filled, or we have to fine tune the application by we have to fine tune the Java stacks by setting the minus XSS parameter. That's all about the runtime data areas. If you observe here, method this PC register, Java stacks, and native method stacks are created per each thread in your class file. So stack frames of thread T1 cannot access the methods that are executing in the stack frames of thread T2. In the same way, methods that are executing in stack frames of thread T2 cannot access the methods that are executing in the stack frames of thread T3. So it is kind of thread safety for the methods that are getting executed. In the same way, program counter registers as well, native method stacks, they cannot access the methods that are the program counter registers of another thread. But coming to this method area and heap area, they'll be created per JVM instance across all your across your class. Okay. Per JVM instance. Next, that's all about the runtime data areas. Let me go to the next component, that is execution engine. Execution engine, right, has the following components like interpreter, hotspot profiler, JIT compiler, garbage collection. They all interact with the native method interface and the native method libraries. What is an execution engine? Okay. Basically, it actually stores the execution of the bytecode on the native operating system. Once the data, once the bytecode is loaded, resolved, verified, right? All those steps are completed by the class loader subsystem and the that bytecode is loaded into the memory areas. It picks up, the interpreter picks up the instructions from the memory areas first. And Java interpreter takes the bytecode from there and finds out what native operation has to be performed on the native operating system and executes it. Native operations by the interpreter are done by using native method interface. There is a native method interface available along with your Java installation, which uses the native method libraries that are present in your JVM. Okay. So let's say for example, if you are running your Java program on your Windows machine, in your JRE, you will be finding so many DLLs. So those DLLs will be invoked from this native method interface, and this native method interface, this will convert the bytecode. Interpreter will call, okay, interpreter will call to convert the bytecode, will call the native method interface to convert the bytecode into the native operating system instruction and executes it, and to execute it. Once the interpreters, along with the interpreter, right, we also have the JIT compiler. When a set of statements like in loop or keep getting executed repeatedly, then this won't be interpreted or converted to platform specific code every time by the interpreter. As we mentioned earlier, interpreter will be converting the bytecode into the platform specific instructions with the help of native method interface and execute them with the help of native method interface, right? So whenever let's say for example I have a loop, for loop, and in for loop I am adding sum of 100, I'm doing sum of 100 numbers. It is just a sum operation, right? So whenever that kind of loop statements or loops are getting keep on executing, every time that won't be interpreted or converted to platform specific code by the interpreter. Instead of that interpretation, JIT compiler comes into picture, compiles these repeated instructions and keeps ready the target platform code. No more interpretation is required for those set of instructions. It's only the execution is required. It's only the one-time compilation, that is one-time creation of the platform specific code. And next time onwards, it is just interpreter just takes that platform specific code which is already created by the JIT compiler and executes it with the native operating system. That is the task of the JIT compiler. Let me go to the hotspot profiler. Okay, hotspot profiler always looks at the how the execution is going on. Like in our earlier example we mentioned, right? If the some set of statements are being executed repeatedly, hotspot profiler finds it out, and it helps the JIT compiler comes in place to speed up the execution. How the execution is going on, that will be monitored by the hotspot profiler. The garbage collector is actually responsible for cleaning up the unused objects in memory areas. Like if at all any unused objects are present in your heap area, they will be cleaned up from the heap areas time to time. That is the purpose of the garbage collection. That's all about the execution engine, and that's all about the JVM architecture. We saw the different subsystems, like class loader subsystem, what are the different data areas, how the class is loaded, how the class is loaded into these method memory areas, how the methods are loaded, how the methods get executed, how the class level data will be stored, how the execution engine comes into picture once the data bytecode is loaded into these memory areas by the class loader subsystem, right? We have seen all that concept in detail. And it's time to say thank you. Please like, share, and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.